Hello. Today I would like to speak to you about Lili Boulanger. She was 24, going on 25, when at the very last year of World War I in 1918, she died on March 15th, few months shy of Debussy's own death in the fall of that year, to the great sadness and loss of her 6 years older sister Nadia Boulanger, whom 70 years later, as a under 7-year-old almost child, I met. And during all the almost 10 years I studied with her daily, Monteverdi, Buxtehude, Fauré, Stravinsky, Bach, Mozart, Chopin, Beethoven, Haydn, Debussy, Ravel, of whom Debussy and Ravel and Fauré were, for the one teacher, for the other co-students and friends, her father's friends being Gounod, Fauré, coming home to have dinners, as they used to often among circles of friends do in Paris. And 6 years old Lili and 13-year-old Nadia in the turn of the 1900s on that very year would be the one to side treat their latest melodies, our French art songs, Lili singing and Nadia playing the piano. In all these years I studied with her, she could have made me a Lili Boulanger fan, just by obligation, or because for 60 years after her sister's death she kept carrying the guilt, but of course the torch of the musical aspect of her sister's music beyond the tragic early death due to a degenerative disease which she fought most of her young age. And during a World War I, which didn't help a lot, if I can imagine, with the follow-up of the Spanish flu. So, Mademoiselle Boulanger knew personally, as I mentioned, Stravinsky, of course, Fauré, her teacher, Ravel, who was also a Fauré student, Debussy, the friend of Lili, and so many more, Poulenc, in the French world of music before World War II, that she could have used a lot of anecdotes in her different teaching, either to feel good about her distant past, because most people who knew her then with them were no more around when I arrived. So she was a sole survivor for having lived such longevity, which to me was a blessing, even if I had to discover all this ecosystem that she was carrying in her soul, heart and mind. Though I remained always very open to her students' novelties in terms of composition or any. But she did not insist on Lili Boulanger's legacy in terms of obligation by the disciple whom I became in the last years of her life. And for many years I tried to think, because I studied with her and therefore she made me discover everything there I know of music, or better, she taught me how to discover it by myself, for those pieces which she did not attend to the sight reading sessions with analytical exclamations and solfeging combinations of notes that couldn't be played if the orchestra score is too large for the small fingers. Yeah, she did not want me to play Lili Boulanger because of her, and I didn't want to think of Lili Boulanger as a composer only because of the tragic death of the young sister of my teacher. Though in the apartment in Rue Ballue in Paris, there were chimneys which are no more in use, but they have beautiful mantles, and on top of each of them there is a statue of the bust of Lili with fresh flowers, as if she died just recently when I arrived. Almost two Lili Boulanger lives long after her own death, which is unbelievable in longevity. But the music by itself of Lili Boulanger leaves a profound effect on the listener, and I believe also on the performer. And again, outside of the context of associating it to her life. Because of the Slavic mom that they had, ostinato was a big thing, even if with Fauré's teaching, moving melodic basses became essential. So perhaps, in a way, it's a Franco-Russian combination of flexibility of the counterpoint and a certain steadiness of the harmonic ostinato that settles in, either in major to thrive, either in minor to mourn. It's a mourning. It's a mourning thing, the ostinato in minor. And I must say that as a child, I grew up to know about her more than about her music, because not of the anecdotes that her sister would share with me, but of the fact that she would always compare my progression in harmony and fugue and contrapoint exercises according to the progression she mentored of her 6 years younger sister Lili. Of course, Nadia was to be set to the first woman composition winner of the Rom Prize, given by the French Academy for the Villa Medici resort, so to say. That was offering 2 years of blissful life for musicians who won't need to work to live, just create. And also painters and sculptors and architects, and live in the midst of the tradition of this millennial city in Rome, while being published and commissioned, and basically their career was launched. But there was one a year out of so many, in a very tough competition where they are locked in castles in France to write all kinds of exercises, choirs with piano and fugues, and a cantata on a given text. Saint-Saëns, presiding the jury, refused it twice to my teacher. I'm not going to go in depth about the reasons. But the fact is that Lili, in her first try, which was unusual, given the complexity of the pyramidal choice of one person out of so many to win the Grand Prix de Rome, 18-year-old Lili, just at the beginning or prior to a few months of the beginning of World War I, won first woman that composition prize. Though Mademoiselle Boulanger, Nadia, was not at all very interested in, well, perhaps flattered, I guess, but not so much by all these medals and these legions of honor which she carried anyway on her jacket side, because she was proud of France. But I don't think that she estimated somebody just by their credentials. It was also by who and what they are, what they do. Just like with students, some came with just unbelievable talent and others struggled. And I think, without to be moralistic, she really appreciated the hard work, if possibly by the very talented as well. But usually they're more lazy, as she used to say. Character is more defining than talent when combined, rather than lack of with talent that doesn't go far away, not far enough. So she came up with this formula about her own compositions. I speak of Nadia, probably, I think, associated by guilt of her sister's early passing after this incredible triumph as a composer recognized at such an early age, that her own music, quote-unquote, is unnecessary and well-written, but not needed, and comparing hers to Lily's being inspired. I guess the difference between know-how and inspiration is probably between the two sisters, though we'll never know how much Lily would have composed evolving in her character, personality, and styles, and how much Nadia would have composed, or the sisters could have co-composed together, since they were so individual and connected. But she devoted Nadia her many, many decades of life after Lily to her students' music, from Copland Symphony for organ, which she played the part of the organ, and commissioned works to so many through her very influential patrons, friends, like Princesse de Polignac, to even Stravinsky, to the Bliss in Dumbarton Oaks in D.C., conducting some of their works. And with rare exceptions, like the 1962 New York Philharmonic invitation by then Leonard Bernstein in charge of it, she conducted Fauré's Requiem, her teacher, and psalms for choir and orchestra of her sister Lily. Almost like a ritual program, a bit like this March 15th mass held at the Trinity Church in Paris in honor of her sister and her mom, dead on the same day, March 15th. And students would play the Pia Jesu of Lily and the Lux Aeterna of Nadia. It would be a tradition, and students didn't know why, well, except for some stayed longer and understood. And but even with all these few situations where her sister's music was promoted either through commemoration, contextually so, the Nocturne and Cortège for violin and piano was one of the first things I got as a student to get familiar with of her music during my teacher's life. And this nocturne starts on an ostinato, as I mentioned earlier, of dominant, of F major, empty octaves of Do or C in English. And she kept telling me to not play them like drops, but like connected beats with energy between the weak and the strong beat, like the second to the third, and so on and so forth. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So not establishing a mode, not establishing even a tonality. And after this, only two bars in reality, introduction, which I indulge playing now, for I don't know how many. The violin and the piano enter on the second degree in major and minor. During those lessons, I would have the opportunity to sight read prepared, not random, scores with a page marked with my name, Emile, and after my academic part of the lesson, trying to not place too many parallel fifths and come with some more ingenious, hopefully smart at least, voice leadings in contrary motion. There was the portion I favored the most in the lesson, that was the sight reading in her presence. She always had Lieder cries, always had these cycles of Schumann's Lieder, which she made me sight read, transposing, solfeging, and many things. Of which Mondnacht, Moonlight, that starts also on 5 with 2. Suspended on a dominant that acts like a tonic to the second degree, got, which is the original key, since I've played it in every possible key for her. Probably in E flat. And even Schumann has an ostinato with a second degree. Lili Boulanger is also on the dominant with a second degree. And he has the same level of intimacy, of tenderness, of suspended expectation. And as my teacher would say, and after all, you mention all these different moods that connects to our soul, heart. It's only what the music itself is. The language of music does not need words, while teachers do. And it was very interesting to observe how much she was involved with the music itself, because when she gave examples of the Schumann Fantasy, starting also the dominant with a second degree embedded in the arpeggio, Schumann song, or Lili Boulanger's, or Chopin's Barcarolle, establishing the dominant bass and the second degree in first inversion. To finish, to start on the introduction's end with. Also, I think what she used to say about Lili Boulanger's music is that she compared it to Schubert's music, about whom she mentioned, if we ever had time to imagine copying by hand, let less composing, all the notes he wrote during his 30-some years on life, of life, we would be puzzled how much he wrote, just mechanically copying it. And she found that he had a level of innocence in his music that is also in her sister's music, adding that while other composers used to search for a musical language through a technique with various adaptation of tonality or leaving tonality between polytonality on the side or possibly octatonic, ton semitone, semitone, ton, semitone, semitone. Well, anyway, she mentioned that she thinks that for some like Lili and Schubert in their music, they didn't need to rethink the system in which, or which they received, so to say, the alphabet that they got at their birth. They just speak their mother tongue, but they express personal thoughts that don't look like anybody else, even if they use the common pool. But she didn't dismiss in her mind the fact that composers like Beethoven, Schoenberg, Stravinsky to a certain extent, for whatever reasons, intellectual or both revolutionary by need or conviction, had to disrupt their status quo. Whenever, Ravel is a good example also of one who did not. But let's say Lili Boulanger and Schubert in her eyes just wrote by inspiration and were not needing to change the language in order to express what unique they had to say. She also composed, next to this nocturne, Cortège, sort of like a light, perhaps horse ride, very spirited. And Lili Boulanger, who liked very much Buddhism, wrote even a Buddhic prayer for orchestra, choir, and singers later, well, not that later, since everything was not late in her life. She often wrote without leading tone, as the theme melodically in the violin. So, lightness and then poetry. But very often, descriptive titles for well, there is activity in her writing, but mostly is observing, as if nature blends in her harmonic language. I mean, the nature of the landscapes and the meaning to the higher elevation of the spirit. And she wrote a theme. Which she developed in two ways. One very spring-like, hopeful, morning of spring morning. You could almost hear the birds on the branches. Oh, again, I'm cheesy, I shouldn't say. Very unprofessional of mine to evoke her music by singing it so badly. So, though I promised myself I won't sing when I teach, because I thought it was silly already when I was a student, but I guess the mirror of time. Anyway, so. Or. Couldn't be more juvenile in the best sense of the word, meaning joven. Youthful. And then the same theme she adapted for a morning song. So she was exploring moods, she was exploring modes, she was exploring the harp after obtaining an opportunity to attend the premiere of Peleas, or around it with my teacher, who mentioned, by the way, that the audience was so afraid of dissonances of this Debussy's only opera, that the reviewers warned the future viewers of the opera that the dissonances are very disturbing to the ear, that the audiences supposedly applauded after the orchestra tuned, thinking they already went through the overture with the most dissonances that an orchestra tuning all at the same time produces, inevitably. And in 1925, at her Rice Conference in Texas, when she was still in her not even 40s, barely, she spoke about modern music in France, starting with that statement that the dissonances of yesterday are the consonances of tomorrow. So the whole concept of Lili Boulanger's music is probably more about experiencing a very emotional connection to nature, a bit like all the Impressionist painters at the same time, as well as a spiritual connection, perhaps due to her disease at a very young age, bedridden most of the time, but with very graceful, powerful, well, both, will. And when she was to die in her mid-20s in 1918, she composed a Pie Jesu like the one of Maître Fauré, which is more luminous. Of Lili Boulanger. I'm sorry. Pie Jesu of Fauré. In his Requiem. I was a Freudian slip, if any, connecting my teacher's music to her teacher, who she loved so much and admired as a father she perhaps wished to have, as a figure at least. And then Lili's Pia Jesu is tortured in chromaticisms, but in a very interesting way, only the tonal chords are minor, but the chromaticisms are major, like G minor, and then major thirds, and then minor for establishing of the tonalities. Comes to one of my thought processes, why is the chromatic scale often associated to minor, with the chromatic fantasy of Bach in D minor to start with? Why isn't it just neutral, since it's succession of semitones? There's no major or minor. But most composers, the tortured nature, I guess, of the expression of the semitones chromatically, which in Greek means colorful, I don't know if that's connected at all semantically to it, but anyway, fact. She writes in G minor chromatically. With dissonances that are so more powerful and painful rather than because they're not screamed. They're sort of like sinking inside very insidiously and you cannot escape but through the voice. If the voice tries to get out of this and elevate itself to soar in the sky like a bird or an angel, while terrestrially the hard work of the movements, almost like a repetitive clock of the chromaticisms, Boulanger's Pia Jesu to a depth that Fauré didn't think of in his Requiem earlier when he writes a Pia Jesu. So the other piece I mistakenly quoted as Fauré is very much inspired in fact by Fauré, since it starts with a triad like the Pia Jesu of his. Originally was a song about love, which at her sister's death she placed in a joint commemoration with the Pia Jesu of her sister's music as a tribute to her sister, where the Pia Jesu became Lux Aeterna. There you go, Mademoiselle Boulanger, my teacher, would have been very upset that in an opportunity to speak and play to you about her sister, I still use her own music. But I can't escape it. I think the two sisters were primarily inspired, even if Nadia was so much more trained in the craftsmanship of music, and Lili perhaps less, or under the guidance of Nadia, though Lili has something about her music that, even if it's possibly connected to Debussy, it's really her own, or Franck, but really her own. Mademoiselle Boulanger didn't like so much these filiations in music because she considered there is no spontaneous generation. And when she was even asked at a newspaper interview about my works as her late years young student, she used to say Shostakovich, but not really. Bartok, but not totally. And she considered that even my earlier works were already very personal, in the sense that I intuitively had found some kind of musical language, perhaps or beyond my native Bulgaria from my father's side, and Greek from my mother's. And not a cosmopolite in Paris, nor a foreign because of her. And so to go back to Lili, I think she also grew up in these strong influences of her musical background family. And explored things her own way. And when she was preparing the Rome stay at the Villa Medici, she wrote a theme in variations on which her sister Lily Nadia had written like riddles on each variation's staff start before to be written, I assume, how to organize the development of the thematic material in a very down-to-earth way, like a Beethoven development, you know, like very systematisch, as the Germans would say. And Lili manages to use all these dictatorships of a very, I would say, academic teaching, which obviously Nadia thought was necessary for a young girl like her sisters, who, while inspired, didn't have a lot of framework into how to search for the note juste or the melodic line's exact organization. But I think she was fascinated that Lili, no matter what, in her music, was mature by intuition rather than by knowledge. And I think perhaps she completed a bit her works when some of them were left unfinished, but that is anecdotic and it's not necessarily a proof of anything. I think it was just that they bathed in the same musical ecosystem, as I like to call it, for all these musicians of the time. So for all of them, they wrote major nines. And more or less, I'm making it up right now, but full tones. And mostly chords. Not with a functional harmony, with a system with a tension release, more like colors in atmospheres. By thirds like Fauré, Franck, Debussy, and all. And I think that when Lili Boulanger exposes the theme, filled with secondary dominance, more or less, colorizing instead of using just C minor chords. Thankfully, she didn't do that. Oh, it's always very, revealing when you try to give an example of what it could have, and hopefully it wasn't. But she wanted to have the melody of the theme exposed naked alone as a cantus firmus, just like almost a Gregorian. Also on the dominant. So of course you have arpeggios. Different ways of developing the thought, but beyond the exercise style compositional task that obviously that must have been, Lili cannot write other than inspired. And Mademoiselle Boulanger, Nadia, I always have to precise who is the two I'm speaking of, she never let me know about this theme and variation. I discovered it after her death through Mademoiselle Armagnac, one of her vestals who used to be taking care of her score copying when she was preparing conferences. And she said, I think you should know this piece. As well as a piece by herself, Nadia, called Vers la vie nouvelle, To the New Life. Just written after 1918's, rather, end of World War I more than her sister, obviously, because I don't think she looked forward to a new life without her sister and her beloved Pugnot, who died a year before in her arms in Russia on a tour in 1913. Well, it's 5 years before Lili died, but anyway, I always confuse Lili's life in World War I times, but she also sent packages for the American soldiers and organized what would become the American School of Fontainebleau as a project, but she didn't survive enough to see it happen, as her sister since did, 1921 onwards with Copland, a student. Now all these things are very distant to most of us, because none of us, and especially I, did not meet anybody who knew her, meaning Lili, given the time. But the idea of Lili Boulanger as a composer, not only because woman, but also because of her willpower to compose no matter what obstacles, I think troubled a lot my teacher in a negative way, to stop composing herself, as if to cast shadow. But that is psychological bubble guessing. It doesn't matter. As again, my teacher would insist, it is the works that matter, not the lives of the works. The work belongs to all of us once it's there, not even more to the creator of it. It's up to us to, in the eye of the beholder, cherish it, carry it, teach it. Hopefully not misunderstand it, or perhaps beautifully misunderstand it. Sometimes they are fantastic renewals that happen with fresher point of view rather than traditional. And I think that when Lili Boulanger's music was played, like the pieces with voice, she wrote a whole cycle, Clairière dans le ciel, for high-pitched instrument singing, singer, instrument singer. And the first one starts. Very much like the opening of the Nocturne for violin, with this ostinato. And Mademoiselle Boulanger's On to the New Life also starts with ostinato. From the dark to the luminous. I think that Lili Boulanger was inspired by many changing things in her time, and probably she would have been more of an innovator had she pursued. But that is only a guess, and it doesn't mean much since nobody can prove anything of it, since there was no life left, nor new life to develop it. In the case of Lili Boulanger, she would write chromaticisms or major nines. And harmonizations that would be luminous but tender, bittersweet. To give you an example, in the Pia Jesu, avoiding the leading tone, pentatonic, perhaps, or perhaps just avoiding leading tone. I don't think that necessarily at her age she had an idea of using one system of tonal, let's say, organization or new organization of the sounds. It was more about just expressing herself. Must have been so freeing for her compared to her own sufferance in her body and the very ambitious and successful older sister. Lack of dad, died young for her age, 6-year-old. And her relatively young mother, who was not a musician but very authoritarian and goes as far as when Lili Boulanger wins the Rome Prize, her mother makes her cry and tell her that perhaps she didn't deserve it or perhaps Nadia should have had it. I don't know what she told her, but in her diaries, Lili writes, "Mom made me cry the day of my Rome Prize," when normally it should be a cheering congratulation. But who are we to judge out of context? Perhaps she was a tiger mom. So this liberating of composing timeless music away from styles and perhaps fascination to seduce musically. She didn't have to. She had to go to the heart of things. Her song "Street of Death," about a mom going back on the grave of dead child. All of these things could be considered artificial or just arranged, organized. After all, how much did she know of life to know of sufferance? Of course, being a woman, she never went on World War I's front. But I still think that just like Chopin's revolutionary etude did perhaps as much as his fellow Polish men with their weapons against the Russian occupation, I think Lili Boulanger's music leaves a more deep groove in whoever hears it than most other music that are well written of the time period. Somehow it leaves an aftertaste when you hear it. Something that deeply roots in you, and you go, oh, she's like nobody else, even if she sounds like most of these others. I would say that when you hear something so profoundly intense as this kind of chord of C minor, you have the Pathétique by Beethoven, or you have even the relatively less dramatic Dumka by Tchaikovsky. So many C minor pieces that are dramatico, the Beethoven's Fifth Symphony onwards, the Sonata Opus 111. So to choose a tonality for a composer is not a gratuitous choice. Of course, we don't really know what it really means. We can associate synesthesia colors to tonalities or sounds, like Scriabin insisted to for his imagination. But then again, it's in his eye of the beholder, literally, since it's colors. But I still think that knowing some pieces of music as she was exposed to through her sister, who was such a really young scholar, and her older sister, tutor, she must have chosen a tonality for him, for her theme and variations, in order to be dark and pathetic. It's almost like these harmonies are like paintings of the melodic line. Almost each chord has to have some kind of a contrastic meaning of hope or despair, or drive, or unanswered question. Half diminished seventh after a rest, or before the rest, then after comes the augmented fifth. Instead of... opening to an A major ninth, dominant apparently of B, but not. Which is an altered degree for instead of... So of course, if we harmonize it with more expected degrees of the tonality, we can find something perhaps less well, not banal, that's not right. Perhaps it'll be just more flowing. Instead of... it adds more darkness in the eloquence of the rhetoric of the... God, all these words. sounds very didactical, but it's not meant to be. It's modulations or just displacement by thirds. You could say it's because she's a young student, so she learns from Franck. Yes, perhaps. Influences come in subconsciously or consciously. But there is something that she says about music in terms of inner truth that comes out through her different musical choices. In a way, you forget the coating of the style. You hear the essence of the mood that is created. That can be taught for many composers with far more many years than her of experience. Not that experience suppresses necessarily inspiration and melodic line. Sometimes it's better to know less in order to be perhaps more free. Sometimes if you know too much, you might just self-censor. And some did. Perhaps even my teacher did, paradoxically. Not because not enough, but perhaps too much knowledge, plus life's accidents. So all my 10 years long studying with her sister, I kept thinking perhaps I'll meet Lili Boulanger through her music and I dialogue with her. And when I saw these theme and variations with a manuscript copy written with Mademoiselle Boulanger's Nadia's indications, I felt like I was attending their dialogue between them two. No, she never wrote in variation in major, which is something I always miss in that piece. I feel so bad to have done that just for the proof, perhaps why she didn't. Perhaps in the meaning of the melodic lines, embedded minor mood, it needs not solace in major. Perhaps in relative major. Back, always down to the magnetically calling to go down to earth, C minor. You try to escape. Perhaps I read too much into it. Possibly. Sometimes I wonder how much of the composers we work on, analyzing them, studying them, performing them more or less well, teaching them, recording them, humming them in the car or in the elevator or somewhere. How much of the... perhaps because we love, we put all this meaning into it. Perhaps they didn't have the time or the need to explain it to themselves. It was just an intuitive fact. They didn't know what they were doing, so to say. Of course they knew what they were doing. But I don't think they were acting it. I think they were just doing it. And of course came the big schism after the great virtuoso pianists, composers, Liszt, Chopin, Rachmaninoff, Scriabin, Mettner, Busoni, Rubinstein, the composer separated from the pianists. And after, nothing is anymore the same. In teaching, in performing, in understanding, in accepting, in offering, in evolving, complete musicianship was replaced with professionalism in a niche. Of course, some manage to connect the dots, but for others, it's preferable to separate the doers from the thinkers. It's a bit caricatural, I must say. But in the case of Lili, who was playing organ and harp at home, schooled, homeschooled, Lili was the student. Nadia was probably having in her first student as a young teacher already, very capable pedagogue that she was. And I was so lucky to arrive at the very end of the sunset of her life. So that's what I wanted to share with you about Lili Boulanger. Thank you.